Tabitha Coulter, and I'm with Partners for Automated Vehicle Education, or PAVE for short. PAVE had the opportunity to work with USDOT in the fall of 2020 to host a webinar supporting their Inclusive Design Challenge on the importance of accessible design when it comes to autonomous vehicles. That involvement was incredibly rewarding for us, and we were very excited when the 10 semifinalists for the challenge were announced in January 2021. We wanted to help share the story of the semifinalists and the amazing work that they're doing in the space to address accessibility challenges. We interviewed each semifinalist team and have put together this video series to highlight their innovations. We hope these stories both inspire you with the incredible work already being done by these semifinalists and emphasize the importance of this work to the field and our future. With me now to help introduce the challenge is Lindsay Teal, Policy Advisor at the U.S. Department of Labor's Office of Disability Employment Policy. Lindsay, thank you for joining us to help introduce the series.
Thanks so much for having me, Tabitha. I'm thrilled to be here with you guys.
Great. Well, let's start at the beginning. You know, what is the Inclusive Design Challenge?
Right. So the U.S. Department of Transportation launched the Inclusive Design Challenge back in 2020. And I was thrilled to be there as a detailee for about a year. I was able to help craft the challenge statement. And basically what it is an attempt to incentivize design solutions for automated vehicles to make them work for people with physical, sensory, and cognitive disabilities. The challenge asks researchers and innovators to develop solutions to solve our most pressing access barriers, such as loading, entering, and exiting the vehicle, securing passengers and mobility equipment, inputting information, and interacting with the vehicle in routine and emergency situations. So the Inclusive Design Challenge is there to incentivize industry and researchers and innovators and disability advocates to partner together to come up with some of these solutions so that we can have an accessible deployment of fully automated vehicles and connect people to the places that are important to them.
Yeah, absolutely. And without sounding too blunt, you know, why does the Inclusive Design Challenge matter? What are those barriers it's intended to address?
Absolutely. So I'm at the U.S. Department of Labor Office of Disability Employment Policy, and we know that transportation is a major barrier to even accessing a job. And it's so critical to make sure that people with disabilities are included in the economic recovery. So here's some numbers. Back in 2017, U.S. Department of Transportation collected the National Household Travel Survey. They collected data, and they found that 25.5 million Americans had a travel-limiting disability that made it difficult to leave their homes and to access different destinations in their communities. So out of that 25.5 million, we know that about half were in the prime working age of 18 to 64, but of those about 13 million, only about a fifth worked full-time or part-time. So there's all the data you need to show that people with disabilities have trouble accessing jobs because of a lack of access to transportation. So because of those unmet transportation needs, we need to ensure that people with disabilities have good access to the latest transportation innovations, including automated vehicles. So that's why it's really important to have this challenge and to have the brightest minds that are innovating in this area be able to come together, partner together, and work on these innovative solutions to accessibility.
Definitely. So, Lindsay, what broad social impact do you think the Inclusive Design Challenge could have? You know, how might it improve mobility for all, particularly groups with travel-limiting disabilities?
So Tabitha, people who can drive a car take for granted that they can go outside, get in their car, and go wherever they need to go, whether it's planned ahead or spontaneous. But people with impairments, people like me with vision loss, people who are, you know, wheelchair users and individuals with cognitive disabilities, we have to plan our lives in advance. And so this could give people with disabilities the freedom of movement that we've never had before. So the Inclusive Design Challenge is there to incentivize the development of features that will make future deployments of automated vehicles accessible to all users.
So how does the Inclusive Design Challenge fit into broader government initiatives on these issues?
So the Inclusive Design Challenge is there to incentivize the development of future automated vehicles that are accessible to all users. And recently, the Secretary of Transportation, Pete Buttigieg, said that transportation is a civil right and everyone should benefit from transportation investments.
That's great. And, you know, Lindsay, I really appreciate your overview of the challenge at a broad level, but I also know that this has a deeper meaning for you as well. Could you tell us a little bit about why you're personally passionate about the Inclusive Design Challenge?
Absolutely, Tabitha. So when I was growing up, we had a Chevy truck sitting in the driveway. And every time my family wanted to go somewhere, we got in that car and we went wherever we needed to go, whether it was an emergency, whether it was a spontaneous adventure, or whether it was a trip we had planned in advance. So I just assumed that I would be using that same truck to get where I needed to go once I turned 16 and got my driver's license. However, when I was 12 years old, I started experiencing some vision loss. And it turned out that I had a rare form of macular degeneration that affects youth. So driving wasn't an option for me. And what I learned is that when you have a travel limiting disability, you have to plan your life in advance. And if you're somebody like me who is more spontaneous than someone who plans ahead, that is a bit of a challenge. So learning to use something like paratransit, where you have to, you know, plan grocery trips at least a day in advance and schedule your ride and wait for that ride. And sometimes they're late and sometimes they show up early and they don't let you know that they're there and you're waiting outside with groceries and you don't end up connecting with them. It's really not an equal system. I often say separate is rarely equal. And so I remember the first time that I saw a video, it was an audio described video of a self-driving car taking a man with a vision impairment to do his errands. These are things that we can't do and that you don't think about. You know, when you're a person that can drive a car, you think about running errands. You can go to the dry cleaners and drop off clothes or pick up clothes. You can go pick up food to go. You can't do these things when you're a person who can't drive a car. So when I first saw this video of a man with a similar vision impairment to mine, going and running his errands, going and picking up a taco from a drive-thru, it brought tears to my eyes because many of us with travel-limiting disabilities just never had that kind of freedom of movement. We never had that kind of independence. And so automated vehicles they represent hope for many of us with travel-limiting disabilities. And the Inclusive Design Challenge is a way to work with these innovators and researchers and disability advocates, entrepreneurs, to get everybody in the game, to get all those bright minds thinking about some of these accessibility challenges, whether it's a young man with autism trying to get to a job interview or a mom with vision loss trying to get her child to the doctor's office, or somebody like me trying to just meet up with friends on a Friday night. We shouldn't have these barriers that keep us from leading full lives. And so future deployment of automated vehicles that are accessible to all is the goal of the Inclusive Design Challenge. And that's why it matters so much to me, is this is going to have a tremendous impact on many of our lives.
That was beautifully said. And Lindsay, thank you so much for sharing both your personal and your professional insight for this introduction. We hope you and the audience have enjoyed this conversation, and we invite you to check out the rest of the interview series to hear the stories of all 10 semifinalist teams.